92 just wasn't my year. 93 will be, though. You can believe that.
True indeed. Despite spending several months under house arrest for an assault charge, 1993 has been an exceptionally good year for Dre. His debut solo album, The Chronic, has been atop the Billboard pop charts for over 8 months and has sold nearly 3 million copies. Also, he recently celebrated the dismissal of a racketeering lawsuit filed against him by NWA's Eazy-E. And he just released his third self-directed video for the song Let Me Ride. Hell yeah. Leaving NWA behind, Dre started his own label, Death Row Records, and found a new partner, rapper and former drug dealer Snoop Doggy Dogg, who he first teamed up with last summer on the Deep Cover soundtrack.
He grew up with my little brother, you know, so he's been around. You know, I never knew he can rap. He could rap until maybe about 2 years ago. My little brother had a tape of him at a bachelor party. You know, we popped the tape in. It was funky.
People want to know about me because they don't know too much about me. They know Dre, but they, you know, it's like I'm a mystery.
Dre, who grew up in South Central Los Angeles, got his start as a DJ for a glam rap band called the World Class Wrecking Crew. The group featured Yella from NWA, a group he co-founded and no longer associates with because of money and contractual disputes with former manager Jerry Heller and bandmate Eazy-E.
I guess they took advantage of me not knowing the record business back in the day. But you know, I know what's up with those numbers now. Can't be f***ed with.
Ironically, original NWA member Ice Cube left the band for the same monetary reasons. And now Dre says the two one-time enemies may record together again.
Me and Cube are doing an album, and it's not entitled NWE, you know, to clear that rumor up. The name of the album is called Helter Skelter. We've already did the first song, and it's incredible. It's about the best thing I've done.
Meanwhile, Dre is putting the finishing touches on Snoop Doggy Dogg's highly anticipated solo album called Doggy Style. And what exactly is Snoop's style?
The way I would describe the Snoop Doggy Dogg way of MCing, it's just something laid back. It's like a 1 to the 2, now swing it to the 3. It's the S-N-double-O straight to the P. It's a conversation. I really don't say I'm rapping. I just be conversating. It's just a conversation between me and you.
As for Dre, with a troubled past and days of living up to his gangster rap image seemingly behind him, he says his objective now is very clear.
I'm here to make money, you know, and that's all I'm in this for. Get pissed off if you want to. I don't consider myself no gangster or nothing like that. I'm in here to make money. I like kicking it with the honeys. I love being around women. That's my thing. I love being around women. I love spending money. I like making money. I like kicking it with the homies. Get the homies up, we all chill. Everything is positive, nobody's causing no problems. And we can chill, get drunk, get butted out or whatever. And we straight, that's me. All that other stuff, you know, shooting at another person that looks like me, or fighting with somebody that looks like me, same type of skin that I have, I ain't with that, you know? And that's Dre.
Most people, when they think of music video, think of this. And what videos looked like when MTV made its debut in 1981. Goodbye to you. But before this came another type of music video, which was brought to America by British rockers such as the Beatles and the Rolling Stones during the 60s and 70s.
The very first video I can remember seeing that was a video was on TV, was a thing called Bohemian Rhapsody Queen, and they're all standing there going, I see a silhouette of Scaramouche, Scaramouche.
Scaramouche, Scaramouche, will you do the fandango?
And everyone was blown away by it. You look back on it now, you kind of fall on the floor laughing about it, but in those days it was very revolutionary.
Filmmakers like Steve Barron, who in 1986 won a Video Music Award for Best Director for A-ha's Take on Me, believes MTV recreated the music video medium.
I think 81, 82, MTV really changed things because suddenly there was the budgets to, not from MTV, mind you, but from the record companies. Exposure on MTV meant that you finally had a budget to be able to afford 35mm instead of 16 and had a set instead of a park bench. Then early on came Michael Jackson. Probably MTV was like a year old, and here was this guy with a new album. I actually made Billie Jean for him, and then he did, in the same year, he did Beat It and Thriller. It's exactly what video needed.
Soon, using animation and effects became a hot trend.
I kind of turned to animation and graphics and things, and a lot of other directors did too, and through that middle 80s period, there was a bunch of videos. There's a Cars, You Might Think. There was Dire Straits' Money for Nothing, the Sledgehammer video, Peter Gabriel, and the Aha Take on Me, practically all in the same two-year period.
As dance music made its mark, so did its videos, and soon having choreography became a necessity.
Give me a beat!
High-energy stage performance videos were also a popular video trend. Early rap videos also created their own style.
It's not fashionable to like Hammer these days, but Hammer brought a sense of performance to rap music, which was amazing. Just, you know, the energy and the movement that he's doing, you know, was really, really refreshing.
I think, like, say, 88, 89, when videos became more fashion-oriented, they became, like, more voguey, as it were. Madonna being probably the prime example of that. Strike
a pose. Madonna is one of the few artists who have been able to transcend the many trends in music video, ranging from low-tech to high-tech and from daring to dazzling, bringing a sense of art to the game.
I think it's more moved into the arty era, in a way. You know, we've come back to R.E.M., you know, Losing My Religion and the art of Matt Mahern's videos, with the self-focus and depth and playing with colors.
So what will the next trend be?
What's going to happen is that music videos, as movies are going, are going to become less about fashion and style and more about emotion and more about making you feel.
Instead of training excessively for the upcoming NBA season, Orlando Magic center Shaquille O'Neal spent almost every day this summer in front of a camera, either filming commercials, touring the world promoting his sneaker line, or acting in a basketball movie with Nick Nolte called Blue Chips.
I play a college basketball player. I'm 7'1", 303, which is me. It's pretty good. It's about the wrong and rights of college basketball.
And the 21-year-old NBA Rookie of the Year even starred in a rap video for I Know I Got Skills, the first single off his debut album Shaq Diesel, which was also recorded during the summer hiatus.
First video is a high-energy video. A lot of guys, a lot of girls, a lot of dancing, a lot of jumping around.
On the album, Shaq, who originally dreamed of becoming a breakdancer on the TV show Fame, worked with several noted rappers and producers. But he was originally inspired to step up to the microphone by Brooklyn's own Fush Nickens.
Someone asked me one day who my favorite rap group was, and I said Fush Nickens. I'm a true, what? I am a true Fush Nickens. The management team called me up, and they gave me the numbers. I asked them, could I do a song with them? They said, sure, and then we did What's Up, Doc. Then we went to the Arsenio Hall show and performed. Yeah, what's up, Doc? Can we rock? Yeah, what's up, Doc? Can we rock? Yeah. People from Jive saw that and They offered me a little album deal.
With the NBA season about to start, a rap album on its way, a film project wrapped, and numerous product endorsement deals done, hundreds of livelihoods are hanging on his success. So is Shaq, who's become a walking multi-million dollar corporation, feeling any pressure?
I don't believe in pressure. Pressure is when you don't know where your next meal is coming from. I know where all my meals are coming from, so I don't believe in pressure.
Basketball is really played to a beat.
The music has really made an impact.
I think the element of hip-hop, as far as personally, it gets me hyped.
Music is great, and I try to use it to my best interest to really kind of get myself loose.
Certain song come on, and you're just there bobbing your head to it, you know, it seems to get you going.
The New York Knicks have taken their love for hip-hop a step further. As per their request, the first song played during warm-ups at home games is Redman's Time for Some Action. Time for some action.
No, we're from Utah now, so we ain't gonna be playing no hardcore stuff. But we go into other arenas, and it's be really nice in other arenas. And you start to say to yourself, God, you know, why we can't have this tape to warm up with?
Some players who are hip-hop fans even enjoy listening to records recorded by their competition.
I'm outstanding.
Yeah, we listen to Shaq, even though, you know, it's personal on the court, but we listen to him. He got a nice album, we listen to him. I don't know if Patrick listened to it.
I wanted to get your critique of Shaquille O'Neal's album.
I really haven't listened to it.
My rap album will be out. I'll be with Shaquille on an album. In fact, we'll be touring next summer. I'm not sure if Shaquille is aware of this, but his people will be informing him of that very shortly.
So you'll be known as Marv Fu?
It's going to be simply Shaq and Marv. There you have it.
That's not true, Mark.
In the 90s, hip-hop has slowly made its way onto the NBA playlist, but you won't hear much of it after tip-off. The majority of songs played at arenas nationwide is old-time party rock and roll.
The core songs are the same. You're still going to find that toga rock, that frat rock kind of thing, that Wooly Bully and Louie Louie and Moni Moni and all those kind of numbers. And, of course, in Rock and Roll Part 2, which is kind of the arena national anthem at this point.
And some find the artistic expression which fuels rock and hip-hop is very similar to the passion expressed on the court.
Our fans get a big thrill when athletes go up and like make a big slam dunk, and it's the same as when, say, a guitar player makes a solo on his album and he's really getting talent on the guitar, so, or a rapper just comes out and freestyles.
A lot of guys, when you see their moves, their acrobatic moves, they're moves of ballet, they're hard, aggressive moves of hip-hop. So, I mean, it music and what we do in sports, they combine. I mean, they're together. There is one.
Going back and forth to jail wasn't no joke.
Hit me!
Contrary to his comical stage presence, real-life Public Enemy rapper Flavor Flav has been no joke. What were you going through?
Well, see, let me tell you something. You know, at a time of going through thought trauma. I say like a thought trauma, you know what I'm saying? Because your mind is thinking, you know, not thinking in the right direction. So you're going through a trauma, you know what I'm saying? So there's no type of comedy to that, you know what I'm saying? I was at one of my most serious points in my life and everything, you know? And not only that, but I was at a point in my life to where I wouldn't want nobody to even see me like that.
How much of your downfall was related to drugs?
That was part of the main downfall, most of the main downfall, you know what I'm saying? But, you know, that was because, you know, I was just going through something at that time. But I'm all right now, though. No more drugs in my life. I'm drug-free right now.
Although Flav won't acknowledge what drug he was addicted to, he did talk about entering a rehab program at the Betty Ford Center.
The clinic is so good, not only to strengthen up your mind and your soul, but it also can strengthen up your family life too as well, you know? And I have my children even come down, you know, and come and go through the program a little bit with me so they could see. And my kids never knew that I really used drugs until they came down to Betty Ford and everything, you know? But I had to, you know, let my kids know exactly what was going on in Dad's life. You know what I'm saying? I don't want to hide nothing from my children, you know? And I don't want my children making the same mistakes that I did, so that's why I share that with them.
What about your relationship with Chuck and the group? For instance, when this was all going down, was it a strain? Did you ever feel like you let him down?
No, because, you know, that was my life that I was letting down, not theirs. You know what I'm saying? I didn't feel like I let them down. I felt like I let me and my children down. You know, me and my family now. That's the way that I felt.
Yeah, boy.
Mwah. So what has this rapper and father of five learned from it all?
As a man today, I look back at a lot of the stuff that I did, all the stealing I did and the stick-ups that I've done and, you know, all the wrong things. You know, right now, you know, I really regret a lot that I did. You know what I'm saying? Because I wouldn't want my kids growing up living that life, and I don't want that coming back on my kids.
How has that been, I mean, seeing the Grateful Dead in Las Vegas? Is that sort of a contradiction in terms?
No, not at all.
You don't think so?
Yeah, best place for them to play.
Really? Now, why is that?
Las Vegas can't be beat.
Las Vegas can't be. You work for the Chamber of Commerce?
No, I don't. It's just too much fun here.
You know that your shirt is unbuttoned, by the way. Tom Jones called, didn't need the competition. How do you feel about the Dead in Vegas? Is that a contradiction or a redundancy?
I feel it's more like a social experiment, though the Dead already is in itself a social experiment.
Right.
But here we find that the unrestrained capitalism versus the communal minded spirit. But Deadheads have been capitalized.
Dude, I am going to repossess your thesaurus. Isn't it true that you used to babysit Jerry Garcia?
Jerry Garcia?
Yeah, you used to babysit him when he was little. You were the one that said, Jerry, put down the ukulele, here's a man-sized guitar.
Did I say that?
You said that.
Gee, I don't remember.
So when the Grateful Dead show up to Vegas, how does that change things?
Oh, it doesn't really change. We just get more people partying. We got more partying. Everybody parties.
Priscilla, I need some Percodan. Cookie, you can mock Elvis. He's gone now. Tom Jones, you can't mock. But
feed me, mama. Feed me, that girl.
Elvis is dead. What can he do now? So what would you say is the most popular souvenir?
T-shirts.
T-shirts? Do you mind if I stand back here near the cash register?
Certainly. I mind.
Oh, certainly. Audrey, now I got a big wad of MTV cash right here. And I would like you to take me on some sort of shopping spree, because what I'm gonna do is take some of this stuff to the Dead show and see if I can trade it for some other stuff.
Chuckin', got my chips cashed in.
I think I could do real well at a Dead show with this, because this is sort of trippy.
Oh, really?
You're in a box, you can't get out. You're in a box, you can't get out. Reefer Madness. Hi, how you doing?
Fine, how are you?
You do a lot of trading here at the Dead shows, right?
Yeah, sure.
I mean, people, you know, you don't really need money here.
No, you don't.
You just, if you got something somebody wants, and you trade them for it, right?
Right.
Okay, what do you got that I might want, and then I'll show you what I got that you might want.
Have a warm Coke.
Have a warm Coke. Well, you can see the product line sort of limited here. Okay, you want the shirt? I get both of those for the shirt.
You do.
Very psychedelic
sunglasses.
You're
giving away your kid's glasses.
He won't wear them anyways.
That's great. Your kid will have a retina burned, but I will have glasses. When you look through these, though, at a dead show, everything is,
Everything is always psychedelic at a dead show. You don't even need to look through them.
Well, it happened. Birkenstocks and hair weaves lived together for 3 days in harmony with polyester and beehive hairdos. I'm almost afraid, though, it went so well that maybe this is some sort of sign of the apocalypse. I mean, what's going to happen next? Maybe we'll see a Rush Limbaugh at a Greenpeace potluck fundraiser? Maybe not. I mean, unless it's all you can eat.
There's a bomb on a bus. Once the bus goes 50 miles an hour, the bomb is armed. If it drops below 50, it blows up. What do you do? What do you do?
It's not your basic shoot 'em up film.
Sandra?
No stranger to action or adventure, Speed co-star Sandra Bullock finds herself this time the heroine behind the wheel of a runaway bus in Los Angeles that is programmed to blow up if its speed falls under 50 miles per hour.
So now tell the truth, Sandra. Have you ever been on a bus in L.A.?
In L.A.?
Before this movie.
No. You said tell the truth. Say no.
Do you think you're the sort of person who would actually take over the reins and start driving the bus?
If I was in the front seat, yes. I mean, I think it's a natural reaction if you just, you know, because, I mean, she's assuming when she takes over the bus that all she has to do is stop it. She doesn't know she has to continue driving. Stay on or get off! Stay on or get off!
Off! Off! Hold on!
In real life, Bullock got behind the wheel of a bus again when she took an official road test for bus drivers at the Santa Monica bus depot.
I don't know if you guys want to be standing right there when I start the bus. I don't know. Beep, beep.
Now tell me, what was going on over there? The whole test thing.
Well, you know, it's what you call marketing. What they wanted to do because, you know, they thought it would be a really funny idea if I went through the actual test that the bus drivers go through, and so I came here about a week ago and practiced, and today I took the actual bus test where I had to drive the bus and do all the backwards slaloming and, you know, braking and all that stuff, and now I officially have a Class C license. You know when you have to check on your license, you know, just to pass it?
Right.
Now I get to check the Class C license because I am an official bus driver.
So what did you think of Sandra's performance?
She did a lot better than a lot of these drivers out here, I'll tell you that much.
I personally thought that she was gonna fail this test over here, but she did it with flying colors, and me, myself, I flunked it on the first try.
So is it as easy as you made it look, driving
the
bus?
Yes, actually it is. It wasn't as hard as I thought it was gonna be, and it's kind of cool to have your license, you know, because people are going, oh, she's not driving, and I'm like, yes, I am.
Whoopee!
Hi-yo!
I hear you're a big Pavement fan.
Oh, I love the Pavement. My favorites.
What's the plan?
So the plan is, we thought we'd go and have a look. We're going to have a look. Go and have a look at all the side things, all the little things out there.
Yeah. They need more dresses, though.
Yeah, no, they are.
You guys get recognized? Look.
No, just because the camera's on us, bro.
Right.
Not really.
Actually, everyone's wondering, like, you know,
this. They think that they're probably thinking right now that the counting crows are walking by or something. They're all filing in now, getting their seats.
Hot dogs! Armor hot dogs!
How many hot dogs have you eaten today?
None. I'm a vegetarian. So, but I hear they're making a hell of a tofu dog.
I never eat hot dogs.
Chrissy Hines here, and she's a major vegetarian.
Yeah, she's not gonna eat a hot dog. And I don't think I'd ask her if she would. That would be funny, though.
Now, how many weenies have you eaten so far today?
Are we talking corporate or at the mess hall? I haven't had any, no. My main reason for doing these shows is I get to go on with all these bands and blow them off stage. And that gets me off. I'm a goldfish, baby,
so why don't you feed me? Every time I see you falling, I get down on my knees and pray.
So Frente is playing right now, Pavement is warming up, and then the stage is going to revolve, and they'll be right out there in front of the crowd.
It's my main job. I've mastered the tambourine in the last couple of months, so I feel very confident with this in my hand.
Now, what else have you got down there? They have a couple of beers down there.
I've got a new maraca that costs 50 cents. It looks sort of like a bowling ball, I think.
So how was that?
Fantastic.
Rappers getting ready to go horror now. It's gonna be one big horror show.
Have you ever heard of Horrorcore?
No, not Horrorcore.
No, I've never heard of Horrorcore.
Have you heard of Horrorcore?
No, I haven't.
Horrorcore is a mixture of hardcore music and horror.
The Flatliners, who say they are the creators of this new trend, recently released their debut single, Live Evil. The video, which does not air on MTV, features hip-hop mogul Russell Simmons' nephew, Redrum, rapping from a noose. Is it scary, credible music, or just outright comical? You be the judge. It's mystical deep down in the earth.
Demons is lurking and evil's at birth. I liked it, but I don't know about all the devil references.
Flatliners, man, them kids are out there.
I like it, you know.
What do you think about it?
As far as rapping from the grave, I'd rather deal with the living instead of the dead.
There's also The Grave Diggers, featuring an interesting mix of hip-hop veterans, including RZA from the Wu-Tang Clan, De La Soul producer Prince Paul, and Fuquan from Stetsasonic. First I'll assassinate him, and then I cremate him, and take all of his ashes and evaporate him. The Gravediggers say they use metaphors in their eerie rap to examine the dark side of everyday life. And they say that's not all that separates them from the rest of the horrorcore lot.
We're dealing with innovative producers, innovative thinkers. So we didn't just go and got on a track and start saying, I'm not, evil this, evil that, wicked, wicked, zap, zap, boogie, woogle. You know what I'm saying? We didn't do that. This is, we constructed songs. We constructed music that fits moves of songs.
Production skills aside, some critics say horrorcore is just another contrived music industry vehicle to market and sell rap.
They can't tell me that what I do is just for me to make money. Because if that was the case, I could have been like,